بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، وبعد. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As always, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and all his family members as well as his companions, and may Allah bless us all, and may he bless our offspring, those to come up to the day of Qiyamah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us steadfast on this deen and to grant us goodness at all times. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, this evening we are here to speak about the greatest of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created entire creation, and we all know that he has chosen Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be not only the highest of all messengers, may peace be upon them all, but he has chosen Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the most honored of all creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us, or to grant us this opportunity to soften the hearts when it comes to fulfilling whatever this great messenger has uttered, when it comes to showing the true love for him, and when it comes to understanding his entire message. We need to know that there was a time in pagan Arabia when the people were at the lowest level of jahiliyyah, or ignorance. When we say ignorance, they used to buy and sell human beings. They used to trade their daughters and wives and mothers and sisters. They used to bury the girls alive. They used to worship sticks and stones. They had hierarchies where some people were regarded as untouchable. Some people were regarded as such a low caste that they were enslaved completely. They had oppression to the degree that the foreigner or the person who was passing by was literally overtaken and sold as a slave. They had wars and they spilled blood without batting an eyelid. And at the same time, they engaged in worshipping, some of them, the sun and the moon, whilst others worshipped idols. And mainly in Makkatul Mukarramah, they created those idols with their own hands, in the form of stones, in the form sometimes of even food. Foodstuffs were made into a shape, and they were made to believe that this is actually a god. It is something that can bring you goodness. It is something that can bring you happiness or sadness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the birth of the greatest of creation at that time in Makkatul Mukarramah. And at the time of his birth, blessed were the people of Makkah. And not only the people of Makkah, entire humanity, mankind and jinnkind, were about to witness a change that would result in the whole globe changing, subhanallah. With the birth of this Nabi, of this messenger, may peace be upon him, let us learn to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever we hear his name, he says that it is our duty to say may peace be upon him, or sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever does not do that has earned a sin. So we should say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We send blessings and salutations upon him. And at the same time, the hadith says, man salla alayya wahidatan sallallahu alayhi biha ashra. Whoever sends blessings upon me once, Allah blesses him tenfold. So if I want to earn blessings, all I need to say is sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So as he was born, history in the making, subhanallah. They did not realize, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had caused certain things to happen that we were to learn from later on. One of those things was that he lost his father prior to his birth, so he was born an orphan. From that we learn that anyone who is born an orphan or loses a parent or both parents, it does not mean it's the end of the world. Allah's most chosen have gone through much more than that. Today we have technology. Today we have so much in terms of material wealth. Today we have so many children's homes. At that time, what was there? There was a desert. There were people who could barely afford food. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for His most beloved to be one who was born without a father, which means the father had already passed away prior to his birth. Thereafter, at a certain age, he lost his mother, very young, a few years old, and he lost his mother. Allahu Akbar. So not only was he an orphan of the father, but he even lost his mother. The love of a mother, the care of a mother, lost. Allahu Akbar. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have to choose this type of destiny for the one whom He loves most? For all of us to learn a lesson that when negativity happens in your life, you could just be a chosen person. It depends how you react to it and it depends how you look at it. Look at how we are learning from the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. One negativity above another, yet He was the chosen one, far higher than me or you. If I have 100 people following me or 1,000, He has billions and trillions over the years. Yet look at how He was born and look at when He lost His own mother. And thereafter He was bounced around. If we use that word, it is not so bad, because that is what happened. He was taken by His grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that young age. And he was a fine young lad. His features were the most perfect features created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His looks were something that if someone looked at him, they would not want to look away. In fact, they would immediately feel that connection and that contact. From a young age, he was very truthful, unlike the youth of today who lie even when they went to school and when they did not go and what they did and what they did not do and so on. May Allah grant us a lesson. The success of this man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very closely connected, obviously chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but closely connected to the truthfulness, the honesty from a very young age. My beloved brothers and sisters, it's about time we stop lying in our lives. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was known from a young age as As-Sadiqul Amin, the one who is truthful, the one who is trustworthy. How many of us are truthful or trustworthy, yet we claim to be the lovers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? I ask you the question again, posing it to myself as well. How many of us can be known as the trustworthy and the truthful? How many of us have not lied, whether it is to our spouses, to our family members, to the community members? Sometimes lies which have no real value. We didn't even need to lie, and we are lying just to feel big, just to feel good. Sometimes we utter lies and yet we say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. We utter the shahada that we believe that Muhammad is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and on top of that we are lying. Yet he was known as As-Sadiqul Amin even before he was given prophethood. If we want to be given something good by Allah, we need to be known as As-Sadiqul Amin as well. If not by name, then at least by quality. Is that not correct? May Allah open our doors. May He make us from those who resolve tonight, stop lying. Stop it. Stop your mouth. As soon as you feel like lying, cut your speech halfway down, even if you look like a fool, because you want to please Allah. Don't try to achieve the rank in front of the people through lies, because Allah is the owner of ranks.
قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير.
O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them Allah is the owner of all dominion and kingdom. Allah is the owner, absolute owner. He grants whomsoever He wishes in terms of sustenance and authority. And He takes away from whomsoever He wishes sustenance and authority. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of izzah. He is the owner of rank and of dignity. He grants it to whomsoever He wishes by raising them, and He drops whomsoever He wishes by dropping them low. For indeed He is the owner of all goodness lies in His hands, and at the same time He is able to do absolutely anything and everything. All able, all capable. Young man, people probably had no hope. The leaders of Quraysh were others like Abu Jahl, these names we know them, and Abu Lahab, and Umayyah ibn Khalaf, and the others. These people were right at the top. They were all interrelated somehow. They were part of one tribe known as Quraysh. And they looked at this young boy. They liked him from a very young age. They loved him, in fact. They considered him so grand that when they had disputes amongst them, although he was only in his 20s, they sometimes called on him to help them resolve the problem. Subhanallah. This was prior to when he was given prophethood. Look at the man, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is why we find that as a young man, nobody doubted his honesty. Not at all. He never drank alcohol. He never worshipped the idols himself. He was protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he was young, he had a foster mother, wet nurse, known as Halimatu Sa'diya. And when he went to her, what happened? One day as he was playing with the youngsters, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came to him. And the youngsters happened to see this. And they opened his chest and washed his heart with zamzam. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam returned it into his heart and went away. The children became fearful of this young boy because they saw something strange. They went back and related the story. The days were not the same again for him. This is the messenger. This is how it started. And as he grew up, he was not from a family that had a powerful name in Quraysh. No. He was not from a family that was the wealthiest in Quraysh. I told you moments ago, he had lost his father and his mother. Mom and dad, gone. This shows us that the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not copyrighted to be from amongst those who are wealthy or those who have status. Sometimes we will have people who will be chosen by the Almighty coming from families who are not even known, not at all. Not known at all. It is Allah's choice. He decides. Allahu yastafi min al-malaikati rusulan wa minan nas. It is Allah who chooses whomsoever He wishes to be His messengers from amongst the angels as well as from amongst mankind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him to be a messenger. May Allah choose us also to deliver the same message. Ameen. Thereafter, we find he became fed up with what was happening around him. He was very upset. He was disturbed by the oppression, by the worshipping of idols, that he used to go and think of solutions to the problem or the problems. And he used to meditate on his own, sit in seclusion, because like-minded people were very few. One of his friends were known as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. For your information, Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, that is known as a kunya. Kunya meaning it's not his proper name, but it is a name given to him. It is a name given to him which is more like a nickname. Today we use the word nickname or pen name, Abu Bakr. His name was Abdullah. His father's name was Abu Quhafa. In fact, that was also his father's nickname. Abu Quhafa's name was Uthman. So the proper name of Abu Bakr, today you will hear it and you should memorize it and you should know it. Most of us are guilty of saying we love the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We don't know the name of his best friend and the strongest companion after the messengers. The one who tread the earth, who was the highest in level after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Many of us are guilty of being able to name 20 football players and another 50 musicians, but we cannot even know the name of one man who was the highest after the prophets. أَفْضَلُ مَنْ مَشَى عَلَى الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. The highest of those who tread this earth after the prophets was Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhu. What was his name? Abdullah ibn Uthman. We know him as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. His name was Abdullah ibn Uthman. How many of us knew it? I don't want you to show hands, because we might show most of our hands. So Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhu, he was a friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Just a little bit younger, slightly. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, was one of those who had never engaged in evil. As he went to meditate, one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him. And on that day, amazingly, there were so many interesting things that happened. Let me take you slightly back the build-up of that day. There was a time in the life of the Prophet, may peace be upon him, when he was a very, very successful businessman. Look at our business people today. We have lesson to learn from this man. What a great man. Look at his message. It started a long time ago. His entire history, every droplet of it is a lesson for me and you. Every droplet of it is a lesson for me and you. He was a businessman. What did he do? He was not from a wealthy family. So he found employment. What type of employment? There was a wealthy female known as Khadija binti Khuwaylid, later to be known as radiyallahu anha. She was slightly older than him, and she was a wealthy businesswoman. Being a woman, it was not so easy for her to travel. Today we have containers of ours here in Malaysia that come from Japan, that come from everywhere else, perhaps Singapore, perhaps here and there, perhaps China. One wonders, I don't know, I'm guessing. I might be right, because these are countries we all get containers from. So for a female to have gone up to Ash-Sham, which is now the Syrian-Palestinian region, that was known as Ash-Sham. The proper name of it is Ash-Sham. For them to have gone there as females was not so easy. So she employed this man. And before that she had employed several. But after she employed Muhammad, may peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, she found that when he returned with whatever commodities he returned with, he gave her the account of every penny in our terms. Every droplet of wealth was accounted for thoroughly. Good news to the accountants, there is also a field that is required. But I wonder, you know, they say, may Allah protect us all. We are in a masjid, and I normally do not prefer to joke much in a masjid, because it is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one or two moments of a slight lighter note is not bad. It's also the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to say certain things that make people smile. Regarding accountants, they say that there was a job advertised by one big businessman. Just for interest's sake, let me say Malaysia. In fact, here they don't say Malaysia, they say Malaysia. So, subhanallah, a man here, mashallah, big businessman, and he advertised a job as an accountant. So, three people were being interviewed. The first man, I'm trying to word it carefully, we're in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first man with a suit, not a Muslim man. The second man, another man from the different part of the world, expat, somewhere else, also with a suit, not a Muslim man. The third one was one of us, Allahu Akbar. All qualified accountants coming for the job. So the man, all he did is, when the interview began, he said, what is 1 + 1? So the first man, obviously he is in his suit, not a Muslim and so on. 1 + 1 is 2. He said, thank you very much, you have failed your interview, you may go. As he left out, the two asked him, what happened? They said, well, I was asked 1 + 1, I said 2, he said I'm wrong, and I walked out. So the second man walks in. The second man walks in. The interview ended in few seconds. What is 1 + 1? He thought maybe 2 is wrong, so let me say 11. You know, 1 and 1, 11. So he said 11. The man says, you are wrong, went away. The third one came, one of us. I am trying to show you how it is important to be honest in Islam. But what we as Muslims do today And where the sunnah is, this whole point of laughter came from a point I am making, that when Muhammad, peace be upon him, was doing the business for a woman, he brought back every record. He told her exactly what was owed to her and what happened, and amazingly, he came back with huge profits, so great that this woman was impressed by this young lad, impressed in every way, every single way. Subhanallah. He was honest, he spoke well, he lowered his gaze from a young age. Before the time that the lowering of the gaze was written for the Muslims, he was already lowering his gaze. He was not interested in this and that. He already was training himself and knew that when you marry someone, you don't just marry them for looks, you marry them for their heart to start with. They must have qualities that you need to look into. So the third man comes in. I think we're all waiting to hear what happened. The third man came in, one of us. And I'm showing you, may Allah protect us, with all due respect to our accountants, mashallah. So the businessman asks, brother, what is 1 + 1? The man looks, he says, close your curtains. So the curtains are closed. He says, can I close the door? Yes, lock the door. Everything locked, everything sealed, no cameras, nothing. Look down. What would you like it to be, sir? He says, right, you have the job. Why? Because I'm an accountant, I will sort the books out in a way that will suit the tax man and suit you as well. Whether it's right or wrong, I don't mind. And he got the job. That is the reality of today. We have become so dishonest. I'm saying we because obviously we are honest from amongst us, but we need to talk about points that just make us think. So don't think I'm generalizing. We have respect for ourselves as well as others. But it's good to mention these points, that today in general, sometimes you find the Muslims are known for their dishonesty. Whereas there was a time, even pre-colonial era, and even during the colonial era, where they knew the Muslims as the most upright, the tongue was enough. If a man gave you his tongue, he would suffer a loss in order to make sure that he fulfilled what his tongue said, because it was golden. Today you can have it written, you can have the lawyers sign on it, and still you will renege. Where are we? Where is the man? Where is his message? And what are we doing saying La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we have lost the honesty that we are meant to be having from the beginning? So now you have this man, when he came back with so much, the woman decides, I need to do something. My beloved mothers and sisters, my brothers and fathers who are seated here, I don't know the culture here in Malaysia, but I can tell you something. She decided, I need to marry this man. This is the type of person I'm looking for. She had been married in the past already. But that did not stop her. She said, no, the proposal needs to come. I need to ask. In some cultures, the families of the women will never ever go out to say, brother, I have a daughter, I see you in the masjid every day, really I am interested in getting my child married to you solely because I have seen good qualities in you. Firstly, the brother will just look and say, hey, there must be some catch here, number one. Number two is, the father of the girl would feel that, you know what, I'm too embarrassed to offer my daughter to someone. Here, the best of creation. Against all odds, imagine, some narrations say that she was 40 years old, some narrations say that she was 28 years old. Whichever one of the two narrations we want to look at, no problem. I think the majority would go for the narration that she was 40 years old, but you need to know that there is another narration that makes mention of 28, and that is also a narration that we look at. Whatever it is, we agree she was older than him. So against all odds, one is you are older. Number two, you have been married before. And number three, the man is young, very handsome, he's known as good with good qualities and so on. Number four, there are so many young girls out there, and we have still come up and said, you know what, please, there is a proposal of marriage. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he also noticed that this woman is honest. She is straightforward. She has good qualities. She has the qualities that a wife should have. And guess what? Against what she would have imagined, the proposal was accepted. So my beloved mothers and sisters, do not underestimate the value of a proposal. And the fathers here who are seated with girls who are not married, help your daughters getting married. Don't make it difficult for them. Gone are the days when we, small difference, you know, they are from that tribe and I am from this tribe. And this is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his wives were from all different tribes. Subhanallah. Did you know that? They were from all different tribes, different people. And this is what brought the ummah together. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the man. We're talking about him. There is his message. What are we doing? And where are we standing? We claim to love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but that claim sometimes does not go beyond our throats. So the proposal was accepted, and he had a wife and a half in our terms. A wife and a half, meaning mashallah, she had qualities of a wife and beyond. So much so that the day that he decided sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anything he would confide in his wife. To the degree that when revelation came to him whilst he was in the cave, he was such an honest man, that when Jibreel alayhi salam came down to him saying, Iqra, read. Imagine today if I told you read and you had to say, I can't read. We would even if we had to hold it upside down, if we didn't know Chinese, we would still pretend like we're reading, because we don't want to admit that we are unlettered, we cannot read or write. There was honesty in him. As high as he was, he said, I am not a reader. I don't read. I cannot read. Ma ana biqari. He was told, read again. Ma ana biqari. And I'm sure we all know what happened. Iqara bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaqa al-insana min alaq. The first verses of Revelation. Read in the name of your Rabb who has created. What we learn from that is, nothing is impossible if you take the name of your Rabb. You say Bismillah and the doors will open in this dunya. In the name of Allah, and you believe that sincerely, your doors will open. And after that, he was granted revelation, and immediately when he came down the mount that he was on, what did he do? First things first, he ran to his wife. We know the hadith, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, cover me, cover me. I'd like to be enveloped. And he was enveloped and embraced by his wife. Subhanallah. And he narrated the story. What did she say? Kalla wallahi la yukhzika Allahu abada. Nay, never. By Allah, Allah can never ever let you down. You are an honest man, upright man. You fulfill the rights of one and all. You help those who are oppressed. You have done so much good. We know nothing bad about you. Allah cannot let you down. She took him and went to the uncle, her uncle, Waraqa bin Nawfal. Look at the wife supporting the husband. How many of our wives from amongst us here support our husbands when it comes to matters of deen? I know of cases where a man decides, I love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that I want to start growing a beard. Some would decide that I love him so much, I want to start growing a beard. And the wife buys a gift. I don't want to say whether it is Valentine's Day or not, because that is a topic on its own. Allah protect us and safeguard us. But we buy a sarcastic gift of Gillette together with a shaving shampoo or cream. And we say, wow, I've brought you a gift. What are we trying to say? I don't like that beard of yours. And sometimes we'll say, you know, it's very prickly, prickly. That is only the first stage. Some men will find an excuse. The wife will say, it's growing this side, but it's not growing this side. So cut it this way. That reminds me of another tale. They say there were two kittens, and the kittens found a piece of bread. And what they did is, they were arguing that, look, we found one piece of bread, we are two kittens. What should we do? Instead of fighting about making it half-half, let's go to the monkey. And the monkey will make it half for us. They decided to go to the wrong person, or the wrong, should I say, animal. They got to the monkey. The monkey is very intelligent. He says, I'm hungry today. I need to think of how to get this bread into my mouth. Why must I make it 50-50 for them? So he makes it such that one is slightly bigger than the other. And he says, here you are. So the one says to the other, I think his is bigger than mine, or hers is bigger than mine. So the monkey says, no problem. He takes a bite of this one. And now that one is slightly smaller. So then they said, no, this one. He takes a bite of that one. Now they say, this one is smaller, until they were both gone. So when your beard is growing, don't say, this is growing more, that's growing less. Let me cut this, let me cut that. You won't have a beard. Let it grow, it will come. For as long as you have that love in your heart, kindling for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some people say, no, we shouldn't be doing that, it's not important. We need to emulate every aspect of his life. The way he walked, we should try and walk. That is the love. That is called love. Love is determined by following. You cannot, I want to give you an example. We are in a masjid, but this is a modern day example. You love someone illicitly, illegitimately, something which is wrong. You have a girlfriend that you love out there. If she tells you jump, you won't say no, man. You know, you say I love you, you start jumping. Why? Because what she says counts. If she says I want you to be here at 6, you will be there at 5:45. Why? Don't want to be late. Don't want to be late. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. But when it comes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his instructions sometimes are just abandoned. And we say, no, that's got nothing to do with love. Some people think love has nothing to do with following it. It's just got to do with saying it. If that's the case, how would you like it if our spouses only say it and they don't mean it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the acceptance that the outward statements can equate what is inside. Subhanallah. So we have such a beautiful wife assisting the husband. And the point I was making was, how many of us assist one another when it comes to the issues of deen and even the issues of the dunya? The husband goes out, he needs to work and so on. How many of us would be supportive of that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who have a deeper understanding. Here we have an example. I have just got to the issue of prophethood. We have not yet got further and half an hour is up. Imagine. What a man. We can sit here our entire lives talking about him. We will not be able to cover even a fraction of his life. Because to talk about a whole lifetime, you need 10 lifetimes. But we are covering little aspects. And if you notice what I am doing, drawing example from every little issue that happened in his life. I told you every droplet has a lesson for us in it. So mashallah, he had gone to Waraqa bin Nawfal and whatever happened, happened. Let's move a little bit further. He then one day Allah told him to announce Islam. So he gathered the people of Quraysh at Safa. He gathered the people of Quraysh at Safa. He was As-Sadiq al-Amin. As-Sadiq al-Amin, most trustworthy, truthful, most trustworthy. He asks the people of Quraysh, and they gathered because they knew this man here is a VIP amongst us. He is now 40 years old, and amongst us, he is a man whom we all respect. He says, if I were to tell you that behind this mountain there is an enemy, and they are there ready, prepared to destroy you and crush you, would you believe me? They said, we do not have reason not to believe you. We have to believe you. We will believe you. You have not told a lie to us, and so on. Different statements, different narrations. In a nutshell, they said, yes, we will. He says, so I am warning you of a severe punishment on the other side of life. If you do not believe that there is only one God worthy of worship, and there is none besides him worthy of worship. So immediately they began to scoff and laugh at him. What happens in society today, my beloved brothers and sisters, when a man who is upright comes to us to correct us, we begin to laugh at him sometimes. We are wrong sometimes and we don't want to change sometimes the wrong that we are engaged in. We would prefer to rather destroy or bash the character, they call it character assassination, of that individual than to listen to the message. That is what they chose. They chose character assassination of the man, but they did not know he was beyond that. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that stage, the people scoffed at him. One of the statements was made by Abu Lahab, his own uncle. Abu Lahab says, Tabbalaka ya Muhammad, alihada jama'atana. Destruction be upon you, O Muhammad. Imagine immediately. Is this why you gathered us? You mean you gathered all of us here as though you had something great to tell us, and now you are telling us that, you know, I want you to believe in one God, leave all these idols of yours, stop making this big error of worshipping whatever you've made with your own hands and worship the one who created you. That's what his message was. Is this what you gathered us here for? Destruction be upon you. And a lot of the people went away. In fact, the leaders of Quraysh went away without even batting an eyelid, leaving him. And then they noticed slowly but surely that this man started developing or getting followers. It started emerging followers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those who were close to him, immediately understood, they believed. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, you have Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, a young boy. Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu. Khadija bint Khuwaylid was the first, a female, his own wife. Today we have a difficulty in our society, a real problem. When husband and wife being married, one of them wants to become a little bit more religious, the other is a problem. Hey, hang on, you cannot do this. I don't want you to cover your hair, come on. Like we said yesterday, I need to see how head and shoulders look like in your hair. We said that the other day. Head and shoulders, head and shoulders. One wonders why it is called head and shoulders. Allahu Akbar. Let me not get into that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. You can see not only head and shoulders, buy a whole range of shampoos. But when she leaves the home, make sure her hair is covered. If any one of us would like to develop their spirituality, let us all support that person. If your child would like to be more religious than you are, support him or her. That will be your success. If the flame of Iman is kindled within the heart of your spouse before yours, support her or support him, and you will find that inshallah the whole house will be lit with the noor of Iman. Today we do have a problem. So many people have discussed this matter with a lot of the ulama, and I'm sure that it has happened in this society as well, because all societies have similar problems where people are not supportive. A woman wants to cover and the father says, you're too young to cover, you look like a nun, you look like a nun. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So these people look at Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha. The husband comes explaining that he has received prophethood. She's the first one to support. Support it so strongly. And who was against them? The whole community. Today, we are lucky we are in a Muslim country. If you cover, you are not going to look different from the others. There might be a small percentage of people who might scoff at you, look at you different. So what? Khadija radiallahu anha supported her husband when the whole nation was against him. Have we thought of that? She didn't mind what the whole world thought. Today we are worried. Salah! And we are at the airport and we think to ourselves, we cannot read salah here. Ya Allah, forgive me. I'm going to allow my salah to become qada because of these non-Muslims who are passing by. I fear them and I know you are merciful. What type of hypocrisy is that? The issue of mercy comes about when it suits us. No, Allah says, Inna batusha rabbika lashadeed. Indeed, the grip of Allah is very solid. So be careful of that grip. Allah speaks about mercy more than He speaks about punishment. But to seek the punishment of Allah just because we are worried about one person or two is not fair, not at all. My Allah comes first. You read that salah wherever you have to. Wallahi, you will be surprised. Some people might look at you and love it so much that it will incline them to Islam. Had you not read your salah at that place, at that time, you probably would not have had that opportunity that Allah guided through your actions someone else to the deen. Look at the bigger picture, not the small picture. There are people out there, they are thirsty for Islam. All of us, we are here because we are thirsty for our religion. We want to know something, we want to be motivated. We want to move one step further, meaning closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why we are here. So imagine how many non-Muslims are out there who are not as fortunate. They have beliefs that really can be spoken about in such a laughable manner, and yet they are following them because they don't even know sometimes about Islam. We are too shy to even tell them that I am a Muslim and I am a happy Muslim. I was about to use the word proud, but you know the English language has that word pride, which also means to be happy and content, and not necessarily the takabbur or the arrogance and pride which is in Islam or which is in the Arabic language. So we are proud Muslims in the sense that we are happy to acknowledge that we are Muslims. And we are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that that is how He has created us. And that is the gift that He has given us, whether it was at birth or later on. Alhamdulillah ala dhalik. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as time passed, the people started growing. It is important that you know that he prayed for even for his enemies. There was a lady in the gullies of Mecca who used to hear, and remember, these are rumors. A lot of the times people hear rumors, they don't know firsthand. Today when we hear, when we see a sheikh, they are quick to label him. Hey, you know this one, don't listen to him, he belongs to that group. You see this one, don't listen to him, he belongs to that group. You know this one here, don't, he belongs to that group. The same type of rumors used to happen at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people of Quraysh, what did they say? They said, don't listen to this man, he is a magician. Don't listen to this man, he's after our women. That's what they said. He wants to attract the women folk here. It's not our fault if the women take to the deen more than the men. And they do. Their hearts are softer at times than the men. But the softening of the heart is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah soften our hearts. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik. Oh Allah, in whose hands lies the turning of the hearts, turn our hearts towards the deen and make our hearts steadfast upon the deen, and let us never turn away from the deen. So the people entering Islam, the others began to spread rumor. Don't listen to him. Okay, 2 minutes inshallah. So we have so many people who are accepting Islam and so many rumors spreading about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, after the adhan we will continue with this. Barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu ala nabina Muhammad.